Good morning, everyone. Today we will be looking at critical appraisal of a prognostic study using a tripod checklist. So, just a little bit of introduction to what we will be looking at. So, medical research, the statistical models are broadly divided into etiology and prediction models. Etiology models are studies which look at causal association, like a randomized controlled trial, where a definite association is established between a cause and an outcome. Whereas prediction models are those which help clinicians to arrive at a decision as to what treatment to start the patient on. So prediction models are of two types, diagnostic and prognostic. And so diagnostic prediction modeling and prognostic are two different types of prediction models, and diagnostic is where by predictors here, we mean the score or like we discussed earlier, the score that is used to predict the outcome. And in diagnosis, at the end of the study, it is a cross-sectional pattern. At the end of the study, we will look at whether the whether the disease is present or not, as opposed to a prognostic modeling where a cohort of patients who have risk factors are followed up for a period of time, and then finally we look at the presence or absence of an outcome based on certain predictors which are used, which are also called as scores that are used for predicting the outcome. Okay, so first we'll start with a case scenario. Let us say a relative of a 60-year-old gentleman who was admitted recently for a heart failure has come to the OPD, and the relatives are asking whether what the nature of the disease is and what the prognosis is in the future. So we do a literature research and we find this article. We want to see whether this article can be applicable to our patient. So this study is looked at development and validation of a 14 risk score for mortality in heart failure, which is a community-based cohort study. This was published in this month in the Annals of Internal Medicine. So normally when we look at a cohort study, we use the JAMA users guideline for predicting, for assessing, for critically appraising the study, which starts with how serious the risk of biases and then moves on to the methodology and finally whether the results can be applied to our patient population. But today we will be looking at something called a tripod checklist. So tripod stands for transparency in reporting of a multivariable prediction model. By multivariable prediction model, we mean a score which has multiple variables which can be used in predicting a outcome of interest. So this tripod checklist is used in individual prognosis and diagnosis. This is a checklist which has to be applied to studies which are used in which are prognostic studies which are used in derivation of a prediction model, and this checklist has 6 sections and 22 questions. So we will start with the checklist. First section has details about the title and abstract. So first question is whether the title has adequate information, whether it has it explains whether it is a developing or a validating prediction model. The target population has been mentioned. The outcome predicted is also mentioned. Yes. So here the outcome predicted is mortality in patients with heart failure, and the validating the predict development and validation model is for a protein risk score. So I will be talking about this in subsequent slides. The target population is patients with heart failure. The outcome predicted is mortality. So the title is adequate. Coming to the abstract, whether it has all the necessary subheadings which have to present an abstract. Yes, I've just put a picture of the abstract here. So it has all the, it has mentioned background, objectives, study design, settings, participants, the measurements which have been done, the results and limitations, and the conclusion of the study has also been mentioned. Second section is coming to the introduction of the study. The background and objective, whether the medical context and the rationale for developing the score and the validation of the score has been mentioned. Yes, so the protein risk score is something is based on something called proteomics. So what do you mean by proteomics? It's a study of all the protein present in the body at a certain period, at a certain point in time. And proteomics was initially applied in human genome studies, and currently it has been useful in prognosticating and diagnosing and as therapeutic marker in many diseases, and one of which is heart failure. So one of the common proteins which has been commonly used now in prognosticating patients in heart failure is NT-proBNP, which is one of the proteins which have been studied. There are many other proteins which have now been found to be significantly associated with mortality. So this study is looking at the role of these proteins in predicting mortality, and they have derived a score which helps in predicting mortality in these patients. The previously available information, the study has been done in a cohort of patients with reduced ejection fraction, heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. But this current study has looked at all the wide spectrum, including heart preserved and reduced ejection fraction. So, moving on to the next question, specifying the objectives, including whether the study describes the development or validation of the model or both. So, the objectives have been defined clearly. So the primary objective is to develop and validate a protein risk score for mortality in patients with heart failure, and to see if proteomics improve mortality risk prediction compared to clinical factors. So what they have done is they have used a clinical score for heart failure. There are many scores which are available, like the Famington risk score. Here what they have looked at is something called a MAGIC score. I will explain that in subsequent slides. So comparing the mortality risk prediction using the MAGIC score, they have formulated in the initial cohort, which is the development cohort, they have formulated the protein risk score, and using that score to predict mortality, whether it is comparable with clinical score, which I explained earlier, or is it better than the clinical factors alone. That is the primary objective. Second objective is to explore the potential clinical utility among both patients with preserved and reduced ejection fraction. Third section is methodology. So the it was a community-based cohort study which had taken data from this Rochester Epidemiology Project, which was basically started in 1966. It is a collaboration of healthcare providers, like hospitals, small clinics, primary and secondary healthcare centers, and the data medical record from all of these patients who are visiting the hospital is used for mostly for research purposes. So the data from this Rochester Epidemiology Project was taken, and the patients were recruited for a period from 2003 to 12, and they were followed up up to the end of March 2021. So the initial period from 2003 to 2007 was used for the development cohort, and the subsequent period from 2008 to 12 was used for the validation cohort. So two separate groups of patients were studied, but the setting and the type of patients who were recruited were similar in both the groups, and each of the cohorts were followed up separately for a period of 10 years. So the key elements in study setting, as I said earlier, the development cohort had 855 patients, and the validation cohort had 496 patients. And these were patients who lived in Minnesota. So the Rochester Epidemiology Project is from two states, USA, Minnesota, and two states of USA. So the local residents of those states were recruited into the study. The details of treatment received was not provided, but it is not relevant also, because the outcome which we are looking at is mortality. And all the details which were necessary for calculation of the clinical score, which was the MAGIC score, was mostly available. So the eligibility criteria, all patients above 18 years of age who had a heart failure diagnosis. So based on chart review, nurses approached these patients, and heart failure diagnosis was confirmed based on the Framingham diagnostic criteria for heart failure, where major criteria and minor criteria was used. One major and two minor criteria. And the patients, when they came for a hospital visit, whether IP admission or after an outpatient visit, these patients were recruited for the study, and the blood sample was also taken after taking informed consent. So the outcome which was assessed was 5-year mortality risk of patients with heart failure diagnosis based on the Framingham criteria. And the models which they have looked at were clinical model and the laboratory model, which is the protein risk score calculated based on some lab tests. I will be talking about it subsequently. The clinical model is something called a MAGIC score, which is meta-analysis global group in chronic heart failure patients. So this MAGIC score has 13 variables and a total score of up to 50. 0 to 50 is the score, and based on the score, the calculator will provide a mortality rate varying from as the lower score has lower mortality, the higher score higher mortality. So the clinical model, and the next is the protein risk score. I will talk about it subsequently. So blinding of assessment, no needle blinding was provided, but the outcome assessed is a hard outcome. So there was no role for blinding. There's no, because the outcome is not going to be influenced by the even if the if there is no unblinding, no blinding. So looking at predictors, are all predictors clearly defined, which were used in the multivariable prediction model. By multivariable prediction model, they mean the score which we are trying to arrive at. So how was the protein risk score calculated? So proteomic analysis of samples, and blood samples that were taken were sent for proteomic analysis to look at all the plasma proteins which were present by using something called a SOMA scan. SOMA stands for slow off rate modified aptamers. So SOMA, these aptamers are those which bind to plasma proteins. So once just a little bit about how the studies, how the procedure of this test. So the SOMA was the sample is taken, and in the first step, the SOMAs are exposed with samples. So what the SOMAs are, they are oligonucleotides of single-stranded DNA, and these then bind to plasma protein. They have a very high sensitivity. They can identify up to 7,000 plasma proteins which are present in the human plasma. So initially they bind to the plasma protein. They are then fixed to an avidin bead and then exposed to fluorescent ultraviolet light to make sure that the non-specific binding are all removed, and finally only the specific binding which are found to be significant are finally captured onto the primer beads. And this primer bead with the bound SOMA mer along with the protein is finally analyzed in the assay. So outcome assessing blinding was also again not provided, because again, like I said, the outcome assessed was a hard outcome. Sample size and missing data. The sample size was calculated, but the calculated sample size was not mentioned. They have mentioned the number of patients recruited, but in the sample size calculation, they have taken 80% power to detect a hazard ratio of 1.18 to 1.24, meaning higher mortality with the outcome. But they have not mentioned the sample size that was given. As a result of it, we don't know if the sample that they have recruited was adequate or not. But they have taken a two-sided alpha error of 5%, 8% power to detect harm. And missing data was, so what do we mean by missing data? Whatever data that is not available for calculation of the clinical prediction score, which is BMI, NYHA, heart failure duration, and EF. So the percentage of missing data was very low. So the possibility that the missing data might be affecting the outcome is very less. But they have done something called multiple imputation method, where 10 different data sets were created by imputing, meaning replacing the missing value with the random value and assessing the outcome and seeing if the outcome is affected by the missing value. If the outcome is does not vary significantly, then the missing value is not found to be is considered to be not significant. So now moving on to the statistical method. So they have identified 7,289 SOMAs from the initial analysis. Out of this, the number of SOMAs. By SOMA we mean the oligonucleotide bound to the plasma protein. So essentially what we are measuring is the plasma protein. So after quality control, 7,151 were included, and then They were then assessed for association. So out of the 7,289, 1,342 were found to be significant after univariate analysis. So we'll look at something called which has arisen from the validation. They have not updated the model. They have, the protein risk score has not been changed. There is no recalibration or updation done. So next question is, risk groups, they have, I will cover it subsequently, they have divided the cohort of patients in the validation cohort into four risk groups based on the calculated risk from the clinical rule and the clinical score and the protein risk score. So the clinical score, which is a MADRS score, has a certain percentage of mortality which it will give at the end of the calculation. So based on that, the patients were grouped into four different groups. For assessing the hazard ratio. For validation, so in the validation cohort, there was no difference in the data. The patient group was similar because the same group of patients after the period of after 2007 were recruited for the validation cohort, and the setting eligibility was all similar to the developmental cohort. So coming to the results, this is a study flow chart. Whatever I explained earlier, so out of the whole cohort of patients who were followed up, so initially the developmental cohort from 2003 to 7 had 855 patients, and the protein risk score was developed. So initial univariate analysis based on Fox model, while they have adjusted for age, sex and GFR, because GFR also has a direct correlation with the plasma, the protein value. So GFR, age and sex were all adjusted, and the initial univariate regression showed 1342 to be significant, and then the, based on the Lasso model, 39 were found to be significant, and then finally they have generated the protein risk score, and finally they have calculated mortality. After this, they have stratified the patients into four different risk groups in the validation cohort, and they have looked at the hazard ratio, and calibration utility analysis also has been done. I will present those findings. So the baseline characteristic between the development and validation cohort was mostly similar, except for some changes in the medication between the development and validation cohort. Of some 72% of the patients had beta blockers in the developmental group, whereas the validation group had 83%. And the median mortality, all cause mortality, some change in the median mortality per 1000 person years in the development as well as the under validation cohort, 4% change in all cause mortality. But all the other comorbidities, NYHA, stage, the ejection fraction, the median, the MADRS score, which is the clinical prediction score, was all fairly well matched between the two cohorts. Again, missing data which was mentioned earlier, NYHA class, BMI, heart failure duration and ejection fraction was the missing data, and it has been reported. The number of participants, as we discussed earlier, total number is also 351. And the total number of outcome events in the total cohort at the end of 10 years, out of 1,351 patients who were followed up, 1,013 patients had actually died at the end of 10 years. Same thing, the unadjusted association was 1,342. After adjusting, it became 39. So this is the final result, where they have divided the validation cohort into four groups, as I said earlier, based on the clinical model. So the clinical model is a MADRS score which gave a mortality rate. So the mortality rate, based on that, the patients were divided into four groups, less than 25 to more than 75%. And in the clinical model, they have looked at the mortality rate. So they have taken the patients who are less than 25 years, less than 25% mortality rate to be the standard, and compared to this, with a hazard ratio of 1, compared to this, the people who were stratified to be at a higher risk based on the clinical model, what was the mortality rate. So using the MADRS score, we were able to identify a 2.5 times more hazard in the group which was found to be 26 to 50% mortality as compared to the standard. And Whereas in the group which had more than 75% mortality, the hazard was found to be 10.2%, which was found to be much higher. So this is based on the MAGIC score alone. Then coming on to the protein risk score, which was developed based on the developmental cohort, and which in turn also gave a 5-year mortality rate. The way they have again stratified the patients based on the score into less than 25 to more than 75%, and again the mortality rate was calculated. Less than 25 was considered to be standard, and they have compared that with the other higher mortality rates, and here they have found the hazard ratio was quite similar between both the clinical model and the protein risk score, meaning that the protein risk score did not really provide any extra information in predicting mortality as compared to the pre-existing clinical model. So that is what we find from the hazard ratio analysis. So they have also combined both the clinical model and the protein risk score and looked at the mortality and the hazard ratio. So here some 1 point in a higher hazard ratios compared to just the clinical model alone in ability to predict 5-year mortality. So this is the finding from the hazard ratio analysis of the validation cohort. So this is another this is a calibration plot where let's say for the clinical model, this is the estimated mortality rate and this is the measured mortality rate based on the estimated is based on the score and the measured is the actual amount of mortality. And here again they have divided the patient into say 4 groups. Here's for again mostly correlating between estimated and observed, except for lower mortality rate. Higher mortality is also mostly correlating. Looking at the protein risk score alone, the measured mortality is this and the observed is this. Again, both the bar graphs are mostly similar, meaning that the protein risk score is able to effectively predict mortality, but it does not provide much significantly more information as compared to the clinical model. And same with the use of both clinical model and the protein risk score also. The values are not significantly different, with the variation of almost this 0.2 to 0.3 variation between the estimated and observed. So coming to some, this is the relative utility analysis graph. So this is a graph showing this is the estimated probability and this is the observed. So what we looked at here is, so this is the the standard, which is looking at 50%. If the prediction is 50% and the outcome is also 50%, which is the which is basically the standard. And here the this curve, this type of dotted one is clinical model, which shows that if the predicted mortality is between 0.2 to, so let's say 20% to 80%. So in the initial period, all the clinical model and the protein risk score all have same performance, meaning the ability to predict is not much different. But in the range between this 25 to 70%, in this area, the clinical model is lower down, whereas the protein risk score and the combination of protein risk score and clinical model is higher up, meaning that there is some benefit in using the protein risk score in the ability to predict a higher accuracy in predicting mortality with the help of the protein risk score. But this is only in patients who are stratified to be between around 25 to 80%. So this is called the relative utility curve. This deficit curve and the relative utility curve again depicts the same thing basically. This is the curve indicating the clinical model, where the risk threshold between is around 25, 50, 75, that we saw earlier, and this is the actual mortality. So what we see here is in the clinical model, like I said earlier, again around 25 to 75%, in that area there is some difference which can be achieved by using the protein risk score to be able to better identify the mortality rate as compared to just the clinical model alone. But this is only in the group with 25 to 75% mortality risk. So that is the primary outcome assessed from the validation cohort. So this is again just a reporting of the confidence interval, which is the precision. So the confidence interval and the hazard ratio of the 95% confidence interval is measured here, is reported here. This is developmental cohort and this is the validation cohort. The values are precise, meaning the confidence interval is narrow and it is not crossing the line of no effect. And again, the protein risk score here has a better, slightly better, higher risk of predicting mortality, better than the just the clinical score alone, and also clinical score along with NT-proBNP measurement. No updation of the model has been done after the initial validation. Coming on to discussion, limitations of the study. The patient population has been only in two states in US. So the generalizability of the study based on just those population group is low. So other further studies have to be done in different population group to see if the similar results are reproducible. And again, the SomaScan assay is something which is quite costly, and it's not available for access to normal practitioners. It's only available to through NIH in the US. So accessibility to the scan is also poor. The potential clinical use, as I said, prospective study in a different group of population to look at the performance of the score is necessary to be able to use this score in regular clinical practice. Supplementary article had details of study protocol in the data sets. However, there was no web calculator which was provided for calculation of the protein risk score. And funding is by the NIH, but they do not have any role in the conduct of the study analysis and reporting. So coming back to the scenario again, can we use this study to calculate protein risk score in our patient for predicting mortality to say? It cannot be used in our scenario because of the cost, accessibility to the study, to the assay, and also if the study has to be replicated in our population to be able to use it in our patient group.
Excellent. Let's give it a hand.